Please be advised that Little Miss Recap contains adult language.
Oh my God.
This motherfucker used one show to advertise his business.
I mean, that's smart.
Yeah, it is. I would do the same shit.
Hey guys, welcome to Little Miss Recap, the podcast where we love going to the ranch.
The ranch.
There was a complicated business model this episode that it took me 17 times to watch to wrap my head around what was happening.
I know. It's insane.
Beth doing that math off the top of her head was probably the most impressive thing I've ever seen.
I know. I was thinking of you when I watched that because you're always saying, well, I have said it too, like Beth fucking knows everything, but she like really does. But then I forgot, didn't she work for a bank?
She's not the smartest person in the room all the time.
No, not all the time. But
they want
did
her
work,
to be though.
I know. But she did.
She worked
work
for like an investment firm.
Okay. So like she probably has like some kind of an education though, right?
And apparently she's writing Harvard College essays.
How about that shit? I'm not gonna lie, I kind of fucking love that just because like fuck you, Jamie.
You know? I got a lot of issues with Jamie and his smooth chest. It's gross. Okay.
It's weird.
Okay. So my name's Amy Archer. I'm your host. This is Little Miss Recap, and I am with the gravy to my french fries, the spaghetti to my meatball, Steph. Hi, Steph.
What's up?
What's up?
What's happening today?
Welcome to all of you new viewers. Our last episode did really well. I think people are starting to come around to the ranch and understand the way of life of a cowboy.
You know, we're not the biggest trash bags.
So we got a bunch of cowboys and cowgirls here with us now. All right. So again, the way I'm doing this episode is in chunks of where we are with people.
Yep.
So this is Yellowstone Season 5, Episode 7, The Dream Is Not Me. I don't know where that title comes from.
The Dream Is Not Me.
Yeah, what is that title from?
I don't know. Am I supposed to know it? Do I need to be looking it up?
Did I watch the wrong episode?
No, that's what I watched.
Not in there. Guys, I will say, I think my phone was listening. You guys remember how diabetes tragically died on the ranch last week?
Poor diabetes.
Diabetes shirts were coming up in my feed on Facebook, so they were listening. My phone was listening.
That was awesome.
I got diabetes. I check my blood sugar often. No, what is it?
I got diabetes. I check my blood sugar and I check it often.
Check it often. Okay, so we're going to start in the past with Baby Rip and Rowdy. Now, this was quite the scene.
Oof.
So Baby Rip and Rowdy are out on the ranch and they're looking for those wolves. It's always the wolves terrorizing the ranch. I don't know what's going on here.
Bastards.
And Rowdy says, I'm out here with you when I could be holding that girl's ass in both hands. And Baby Rip's like, say what?
What girl?
Whose ass are you holding? Mm-hmm. And he's like, you know what, girl. And then they get into this fight. Now, there's three stages to the fight. There's stage one, which is a punching match. Mm-hmm. And Baby Rip seems to win that one and tries to walk away.
Yes.
Stage two is Rowdy pulling a knife and Baby Rip has to hit him with a rock. Okay. Stage three is Baby Rip pummels him to death with the rock. Jesus Christ.
Yeah. I mean, did he need to do that? Was that like a gross overreaction? I mean, I guess if somebody pulled a knife on me, I don't know what I would do.
Well, you know my stance on this. If any of you have come over from Gen X, This Is Why, where Jenny and I covered horror movies, you know I always say, just keep bludgeoning to death until, like, just keep bludgeoning until there's nothing left, because it's either you or them.
I know.
And in this situation, I think Rowdy might have.
I know.
Because don't forget, the dangerous thing about Rip is that he doesn't exist.
I know.
So, like, Rowdy could kill him and no one would be the wiser.
I know.
So
that makes me sad, though. He's just a boy.
He's just a boy. So later, Rip runs for help. And as he's going for help, Rowdy's like, just tell him my horse trampled me. And Rip's like, okay, I'm not going to lie. So he runs to John Dutton's house, to the ranch. And John Dutton's like, what's going on? And Rip is like, here's what happened. He was talking mad about your daughter and I bludgeoned him to death with the rock. Like, just right out with it. He is baby narc.
Did you catch how the dude who got bludgeoned, what is his name? Do we Rowdy. Even know? Oh, Rowdy. Did you notice how Rowdy called him Half Pint?
No, I did not.
He did.
How dare you, Rowdy? How dare you?
I know. Right before they started to fight, he's like, what you gonna do, Half Pint? And then that's when it like went all fucking hell broke loose. Yep. Nope, I'm like, how did you miss that?
I don't know how I missed that. You know what it is? I'm going to tell you how I missed it. I hate violence so much. Like, I hate, I shouldn't say that because I will watch The Last Kingdom and I will watch Uhtred go through a group of soldiers and just murder them all, like slice them, slice and dice. However, there's something about like the beating that I don't like. So it's hard for me to watch that stuff.
Do you know what it is? I think it's because I feel I get that, but I think it's, there's something to it because it's so real.
Yes.
Like at least like in a murder flick when someone's being like, like Michael Myers, like we know that's like fucking bullshit. I mean, I'm still terrified of it, but like this is real. Like,
I go from, oh, I can't watch him punch him to, Uhtred, slay those Danes, rip their skulls off. You know, like I get all bloodlust when I'm watching Uhtred.
I haven't seen that.
Oh my God, Patrick would love it.
I think it's Patrick has watched so it, but I don't think good. I did.
So good. So now we're going to scoot over. Oh, so big important point here. John tells Rip, I'll take it. They get to Rowdy. Rowdy's dead. And John's like, I'll take care of this guy, but I own you. Like, your ass is mine now. You can never leave the ranch. And you always have to do what I tell you.
I know. How do we need to talk about that. What the fuck? Like,
is prison better at that point?
But like, I don't know.
I don't know. It depends. What kind of murder charges are we looking at here?
I don't know. I know nothing about the law.
Because Lloyd said, little baby Lloyd said, you know, this guy has no family. He has no nothing. So like, we could just get rid of this.
That was baby Lloyd.
That's Lloyd's son playing that young Lloyd. Yeah. It's the real actor's son playing him.
Because I wrote in my notes, like, when are we going to see like a baby Lloyd? And I didn't even realize that was baby Lloyd because the voice wasn't even close.
Yeah. It's his son playing the role, which I think we talked about this. I'm pretty sure we talked about this.
Probably did. Dude, you know, I don't remember anything.
So now we're going to scoot over to weirdo Jamie, who looks like a Ken doll.
And he's still in the Apple Watch. But you know what I noticed too? She's naked and also wearing her watch. Why are they both only wearing watches?
It's real weird. Just, you know, I'll get to what happened here, but just to skip ahead a little bit. When she lays him down and his head is like over the couch under the harsh glare of the lamp.
Yes!
Like, what is happening?
I swear to God, I thought that is so fucking uncomfortable. No one would actually do that. Like, you would move.
Yeah, this.
That was so weird. And he was in, like, the crook of the corner. Like, it made no sense. It made no sense.
No sense.
That was so dumb.
So they're sitting naked on their leather couch, which I can't even imagine how that sounds. Like, when they move.
Yeah, no.
Jamie is waxing poetic about how he just wanted to be a cowboy. And John took that choice from him because he needed a lawyer. Maybe this is where the title comes in. I don't know. Because he is talking about like his dream and John's dream. And you know what I mean?
Oh, you know what? That's totally what it is.
Yeah, it's got to be.
You just figured it out. Mystery solved.
So Jamie's like, he just needed a lawyer. And I thought, that's a good idea. Like, think about what you need in your life. I need a lawyer. I need a doctor. Send my kids to law school and medical school.
Well, I already fucked that up because neither of mine are doing either of those.
Neither of mine want to do that either. But I'm just saying, we go all John Dutton and make them go.
Yeah, it would be like, Mom, can you ask Amye to write my essay from law school?
Well, here's the thing. So Jamie's like, I didn't want to go to Harvard. I never even applied and I got in. I have no idea who wrote the essay. And Sarah's like, your genius sister, Beth, probably did.
I hate her.
Come on.
I know.
I can't with this.
I know. Me too.
So he says he wants Daddy's approval. And Sarah's like, let me see if I could do her voice. She's got a real, what do they call that?
Nasally.
Like, it's like nasally.
But like nasally, this. Like monotonous. It's like,
yeah.
A very
Vocal fry. She's got real bad vocal fry.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's like, he's scared of you and he's jealous of you, Jamie. And so then she goes into this whole thing about.
You actually do that really well.
She goes into this whole thing about how the ranch is antiquated and the cattle industry, the future of the cattle industry is in Brazil. And she throws his head back on that couch under the harsh light bulb of a side table lamp they make out. All right. So Jamie gets into work and his assistant is like, Sarah Atwood and Ellis are in your office, but if I may, women know women and that bitch is up to no good. And Jamie's like, what are you talking about? I'm not banging Sarah Atwood. What are you talking about? And she's like, dude, you're banging Sarah Atwood. And I'm just telling you, it's no good. No bueno. Yeah.
And like the rest of the world isn't a fucking idiot like you. So people know. What?
I've turned on Jamie real quick.
Same.
I used to have sympathy for him, but no. So Ellis tells Jamie, Ellis is in there with Sarah Atwood. And he tells Jamie, hey, did you know your dad put this fucking land in a conservation easement? And Jamie goes bananas. He can override it, he says.
Yes.
But it's super complicated. So Ellis leaves and Sarah says, Markwood Equities is going to sue your state and they will basically bankrupt you. And then she whispers, this sounds like an impeachable offense to me. I don't know what's happening.
I don't know, but I'm so obsessed with you doing her voice that like it's all I want to hear.
So basically, here's what's happening. And I have to record 3 podcasts today, so my voice needs to rest.
Dude.
But well, here's what happens.
It's like 7 a.m., so you have some time to
rest. I know. And that's why my voice sounds this way, because when I first get up, like, it takes a while to warm up. You got to warm up the pipes.
See, it's a good thing no one can actually see us, because I look like I just rolled out of bed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I did.
I recorded with Amanda yesterday at 7 a.m. too. So, you know, 7 a.m. recordings. So she basically, here's what she wants to do. She wants Jamie to impeach him, John, over the fact that he has made them vulnerable to a lawsuit that can bankrupt the state because it was a bad faith negotiation between market equities and John when he put that in the conservation easement. So Jamie later is practicing his impeachment speech to Sarah, who is now in a teddy on the couch.
I can't.
So, and I don't know if he doesn't
nice
have a
one.
Does he not have a bed?
I don't understand. But it was also from like the 80s. It was like weirdo, like baby pink with like white lace on the like. Get out of here!
I mean, she looked better than I look in anything. But you know,
of course, she looks better than any I could ever look in anything.
Let's scoot over to Linnell's office, shall we? Who is this woman? Is stunning.
She's fucking gorgeous.
She's gorgeous.
Like, I need to know what she's putting on her skin because, as somebody that's obsessed with skincare, and like, I will go starving before I don't have my good skincare. Mm-hmm. I need to know what she's doing because she's so fucking flawless. I can't even understand it. She's beautiful.
She's amazing. She's beautiful. She was always my favorite on my soap opera, but she has outdone herself here.
Really?
So she calls a meeting with Mo and Rainwater to let them know that the Secretary of the Interior is putting a pipeline right through their reservation under their reservoir. And she says, and Rainwater's like, how do they pick the path? And she says, they pick the path of least resistance. And she basically says, like, if you go to the left, blah, blah, blah. And if you go to the right, it's private ranches. And everybody's going to get pissed off about that, including our governor.
Hmm.
And Linnell says she's giving him this info so she could get ahead of it. And she will also publicly declare her opposition. So they decide they're going to hold a press conference together. And as Rainwater's leaving, he's like, where's John? You know, he's our governor too. You might want to remind him of that. So mm-hmm. I don't know what's being set up here between Rainwater and John, but tensions are high.
Yeah, it's not good.
Mm-hmm. Are you ready? Are you ready to go to the ranch?
I'm ready. Take me. Take me to the ranch, Jamie. Take me to the ranch.
The cowboys are getting up and it's crack of dawn.
I know. I love it so much.
Ryan and the singer chick are banging, and, you know, she's giving him a hard time about leaving. Casey's getting dressed, and robot Monica, who had a lobotomy somewhere along the line, is crying happy tears because, Tate, you're becoming a man.
Yeah, that was really, really fucking weird.
It was kind of weird. Okay.
As a mother of boys.
Mm-hmm.
And
do you talk about your boy's manhood?
No, but that's what I'm trying to say. Like, I'm the mother that will cry over anything when it comes to my kids. And that is one thing that I don't think I could ever say to them with a straight face. Like, truly, that would be so fucking weird.
Right,
I
like, think you would have be said like, to me, you have said to me in the past, like, I'm so proud of the boys. They're becoming so independent. They're becoming, you know, they're so grown up. Mm-hmm. But, like, you're not like, they're becoming a man.
Never. No. And I have said to them, like, you're doing such a great job. Like, mm-hmm. I will say, mm-hmm. you know, we're mm-hmm. so proud of you, whatever. Like, you've matured, whatever. But, like, that was just, there was something creepy about that.
Well, Monica's crying because Tate's becoming a man. And Casey's like, let's give her some time alone. Yeah. They leave the tent.
Literally. He's like, we're out of here. Peace.
Now, the men all go off. And as the sun comes up, all the women are creeping out from the tents the next morning. And Beth is calling them all sluts.
Which was kind of funny.
I have an issue with her.
I had a bigger issue with the fact that she was wearing a tank top, like a bathing suit, bodysuit with a pair of jeans. It's freezing in the morning and you're in the woods, in the mountains.
I think what I have an issue with her is she's all like, I'm a married woman, married. Like, since when does Beth like marriage?
I think Beth has always liked marriage. I think Beth has put on that front of like that hard exterior of if I just hate everything and everybody thinks I hate everything, then it can't hurt me.
Yeah.
It's all a facade.
Of course, you know, it's like a third grader wrote this because it telegraphs so hard. Of course, Summer Wheatley, the hippie, hates marriage. And of course, Beth has to rip her apart because she's the smartest woman in the room. Now, Monica comes over and she's like, why are you so fucking mean, bitch? Mm-hmm. Like, what is your problem? Beth basically says, like, I don't dish it out to you because you don't dish it out to me. And then they share this moment where Beth tells her she knows what it's like to lose a baby, but she doesn't really talk about it because it would hurt people. And Monica says, that's why you're so mean, because you haven't told anyone and it's essentially poisoning you. Like, pretty much you're holding it in.
She's right.
I have said this all along. I really think, I said this in like episode one or two, I think she is going to tell Rip about the baby. Rip is going to go to Banana Town and he's going to try to murder Jamie, and somehow Beth is going to get killed in this.
I know. You've been saying that. And every week I try to like find a reason for you to be wrong. But like, I just keep seeing that you're right.
And full disclosure, I'm always wrong. I have real bad takes about this kind of stuff. So
no, you don't.
Chances are everybody lives happily ever after and they walk off into the mountains. I don't know.
What's so fucked up is that that's what I want. And like, but I think you're right. Every week I'm like, oh, I could see it happening, especially as we like neared the end of this episode. I was like, oh, fuck, it's really coming. She's right. I know. And I hate it.
So the cowboys are discovering some stillborn bison calves, and they deduce that the park bison have gotten into the pasture and it's contaminated with brucellosis. Brucellosis is what they call it. Okay. So they're going to test them. And if the cows have it, the state murders all of them. And I just wrote, Jesus Christ, farming is dark.
Yeah, it really is.
Oh. Ranching. Let's make a distinction. Ranching is dark. So now we have a montage of them branding calves. And for some reason, they're forcing Summer Wheatley to get involved in this now. And she doesn't want to.
I do have to say, though. She was like, I'm so sorry. I'm so fucking sorry. I'm so sorry. Like, that is so something, but like, that's so something that I would do.
It's I'm like, just, that's like, totally why is she me. Even doing it? Like, stand up for what you believe in and be like, no, I'm not going to do it.
But I think that was like, no, I think she needed to do that because you see at the end, there's that conversation between her and John.
Mm-hmm.
I think this needed to happen, and I actually kind of liked that it happened.
Okay. Right.
I love – you know what I really love? I love being able to see someone's point of view change on something. Like, I know, love,
but I think that her point of view shifts a little too quick.
Of course. I think
Taylor Sheridan's like
– But she's also getting boned by John. Like, she's just, like, whatever. But I'm just saying, I kind of like it.
By the way, shout out to the reviewer who left us a review about our Yellowstone recaps and said, I would totally bang John Dutton. Did they say Dutton or Costner? I forget what they said. Same thing.
I think it was Dutton.
But thank you for validating us. I feel seen. Yeah. I feel heard.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like less of a trash person because of it.
I mean, I don't feel less of trash, like less trashy, but whatever.
I do. It makes me feel like there's other trash in the world.
But you really didn't find something great in like watching Summer Wheatley do the thing and know why it needs to be done. Like, I like seeing that. There should be like a fancy word for what I'm trying to describe, and I'm sure you'll come
I understand what you're saying, but I'm saying, like, in my opinion, that she could have had the same turnabout by just watching. She didn't have to get in there.
All right, whatever.
That's how I feel. Okay. We're going to agree to disagree.
We disagree.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So next. Now John has to make a decision. He's with Rip and he's with Casey. And he's like, Rip says, if the state kills the herd, sir, will they pay you? And John says, yeah, but 100 years of genetics will be gone. And then he says, we got a bigger problem. If they don't test positive, I can't do this whole monologue in his voice. It'll ruin my throat.
No, you can't.
But he basically says, if they don't test positive and he has to keep them, they can't use the south pasture. And basically, he has to lease land somewhere south where they can graze in the winter. I love how Casey comes up with an idea. He's like, wean the Merle and blah, blah, blah. And John's like, shut up, idiot. That'll cost too much money. Like, he just dismisses them, like, right out of hand. So then he's like, you know, I need to send them somewhere where they could graze in the winter so it's warm. And they have to send half the herd and they need to stay there a year or longer for this to pencil out, which I guess means, you know, erase the cost or whatever. Ooh. And Casey's like, oh, shit, who has to watch them? Because I'm not leaving Monica. You saw that. You saw what I'm being. I'm not going anywhere. And Rip's like, who do you think, Casey? Like, I murdered Rowdy and I owe this to your dad. I'm still paying that fucking debt.
Still paying that fucking debt.
Here's the thing. We did not need that because if you remember going back.
I do.
The whole reason that Rip is loyal to John is because Rip took him in because he had nobody.
No, John took him in.
That's what I mean. John took Rip in because Rip had nobody. He was an orphan.
Right. And John took him in. That's good enough.
Yes. Thank you. That's good enough. That's good enough. We don't need to cover up a murder too.
No,
now we've made Rip a murderer, which he is, and he's not, which he is a murderer, but
he's really like not though.
I hated to see it.
I'm with you 1,000,000,000% on this one. It didn't need to happen.
Like, I think that, you know, there was something almost sweeter about his loyalty to John being more genuine and not blackmail-y.
And that's why I wanted so badly to believe that what I loved about Rip is his sweetness. And there was something that I was hoping that came from that. But not like that just threw a wrench in my theory of Rip's personality. If you think about it, though, dude, it makes no sense.
It just wasn't necessary.
But think about it. He has no family. He's raised on this ranch and worked like a slave.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But he is super sweet to like and not and like has all this wisdom. Like, I just
super sweet though, because he will kill a bitch. We've seen this.
No, but
like, adult Rip, we've seen killing many people.
But he's super sweet to Beth.
He is.
Because we talked about this last week, and I don't understand where it comes from.
Right.
Because he didn't grow up with the mother there. Like, she was already gone.
No, we so got to get not, eyes on that mother. I need know. A little more of this. Me I need. A, why don't we get a prequel called 1966, where we just see the mom and John in the 70s raising these kids?
That's a great idea.
That's what I need to see. And the dude who plays young John, yeah. he's hot. He can stay.
I get Gretchen Mol
back. Bring her back as the mother.
Yeah. I need a young Lloyd. I want to see how young Lloyd, like, I really want to know how Lloyd ended up at the ranch. I want his whole story.
Yeah.
Because I need to know that. Because he's super loyal too, and I don't understand why.
Yeah. You need, like, throw a little eye candy in there. Give us some Harry Styles, Cowboy in the Bunkhouse. Ooh, I'd take that.
Ooh,
no, God, have him singing on that stage.
Harry Styles as a cowboy has just changed a lot for me.
Okay. So Rip decides to bring with him Ryan, Jake, Teeter, and Walker. Lloyd offers to go because he's like, you got a wife. I got nothing here. But Rip is like, no. I'm head of the ranch. I got to go.
But that's my point. Lloyd has nothing. How and why? I need to know.
I don't know.
Sorry.
So they're going to bring Gator. They got to bring Gator to cook the meals. Poor Gator. Justice for Gator. Jesus Christ. Right? This guy, he's like, I'm just a chef and I have to go live in a tent for a year.
Yeah, fuck this shit. And a year? A year. I can't wrap my brain around
that. But we know that this is obviously not going to happen. They can't send all of these major characters off. I don't know. We'll get there. So all the cowboys are happy to go and they're all like, thanks for choosing me, sir. You know, and I love at one point Rip brings over Ryan and Ryan's looking at the girlfriend. He goes, is this going to be a problem? Am I going to hear about this in some canyon in New Mexico? So then Rip says to Ryan, here's a few hundo. Take the boys to the carnival. Go have some fun.
This was so fucking hilarious to me. Like, why does he treat them like children?
I don't know. It's hilarious.
It's hilarious.
Hey, everyone. Stay tuned. Little Miss Recap will be right back after these words. So John is super pissed. Like, he's pissed enough that when he comes in, he wants to smash a Swarovski. Got it. You can tell I've never owned anything nice in my life.
Shut up.
What do you say? Tiffany's? Swarovski crystal tumbler. He's like, I gotta smash something. And he picks this up. I was less concerned about the tumbler than I was about the alcohol inside of it.
I know.
Like, you're going to throw it with alcohol in it?
I know. At least drink it first.
Yeah. So Beth is like, no. That's 100 years old. It belonged to your grandfather. Put down. Throw something else. So John decides to drink it instead. And then he tells her about the Bruce Willis. And I wrote the Bruce Willis. The cows have Bruce Willis.
Oh, God, that's terrible.
Beth starts
his current state.
Oh, I forgot he was sick. Yeah, he is sick. I fucking love Bruce Willis. He was David Addison on Moonlighting, which was one of my favorite shows growing up. Loved it so much.
Fucking great in everything. Love him.
So Beth asks all these questions, and here it is. They have to lease the land. It's going to be $12 to $14 an acre. He needs 100,000 acres at least. She's like, oh, that's $1.4 million for the year. He's like, nope, a month.
A month? That seems
Beth is like, we don't have it. And he's like, I'll take a loan. Who takes a loan for that much?
I don't understand.
Unless he has equity in the ranch?
I'm sure he does. Let's be real. That ranch has been in his family for 100 years. Of course he has equity.
That's true. That's true.
I need to understand how anything costs that much money a month. Please help me understand.
And I need to understand. My in-laws have 60 acres sitting out here. Can I lease that to somebody?
I know.
How do I lease that out for $10 an acre?
I don't
Jesus
know.
Christ.
Insane.
All right. So Beth suggests selling the cows because she's like, what if we sell them? And he's like, well, if I get them up 2,000 pounds, I get $1.50 a pound. And Beth is like, this math ain't mathing. Like, beef is selling for $10 a pound and you're going to sell a cow for. And he's like, we don't sell beef. We sell cattle.
I know. We are in the wrong business, Daddy.
Beth, suddenly, Beth has realized this business model that I've bought completely into for the last six seasons is antiquated. It needs to completely change.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, Daddy, look around. There's no ranches. There's airports. There's hotels. There's strip malls. People sell the losers, not the winners. All right. Mm-hmm. Later we have this scene where Beth calls the 4-6s. And she's asking about their beef prices.
Yes.
And we get the world's worst employee who is giving away all company secrets.
Yeah. What? I know.
What is is there not a non-disclosure here?
I know. It's insanity.
This would be like, you work for like advertising. This would be like somebody calling you up and being like, hi, I'm calling from Sirius XM. Can you tell me how much your rates you're charging for, you know, this advertiser?
It would never happen.
No.
Never.
No.
No.
It's never. Ridiculous. So, and I also feel like
I would be fired.
I also feel like this is kind of a commercial for the 4-6s because Taylor Sheridan has bought that ranch.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He owns the 4-6s. Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
So now I'm wondering if they have like a beef website. Do they have a beef website?
I'm gonna
hold on, guys. I'm looking this up.
Beef
6666 Ranch. Can I buy beef on there? I think you can.
I'm on it.
Oh, my God. Totally
can.
Yep.
Do I need to buy one?
I'm shopping now. I'm shop666ranch.com.
Stop. You really can.
It's not beef, though. Is it beef?
No, it's like, wait, I think it is.
You can buy beef. There's beef.
Dude, we can buy cowboy hats. I'm totally buying a hat.
Oh my God. This motherfucker used one show to advertise his business.
I mean, that's smart. Look at this hat. Go to Cowboy Hats.
I would do the same
stuff. And look at the American Hat Company.
Oh my God.
Hat.
A strip loin steak looks delicious. I think I need to order some of this. Oh, there's clearance meat. You could get clearance beef.
Want clearance beef?
Okay, anyway,
oh my God, there's ranch home, like drinkware and decor. Wait, hold on.
No, I don't want that.
Buying it for. You're totally getting something. Your birthday's coming.
I don't
up.
Want it's that.
Something.
It's I don't happening. Want ranch bath.
Oh, you're getting oh something. God. Pick something out. No, I want to pick candles. It out. Don't even tell me.
Okay. Back to the show.
Oh my God. Sorry, everybody.
So guys, he's literally using the show as an advertisement. So this dude is like, look, we're making a fuck ton of cash here. Like, we are rolling in it. I don't know what else to do with all this money. And Beth is like, okay, thank you very much. Click. So then she tells John about this, and he's droning on about the repacker. Now, I had to look this up. And I went to the source, if you will, which is Reddit. The Reddit. Okay.
All right.
Now, according to the Reddit, ranchers will raise the cattle. Then people slaughter it in the slaughterhouse, but rarely do ranchers do both. So, like, the people who are slaughtering it don't know how to package it and ship it.
Oh, so everybody has a separate piece of
yes,
the puzzle.
Yes. Okay. So it's this whole shebang. And it's likely going to be like a really big investment for John to have to repack it.
All right.
So that's why Beth, you know, she tells him, like, this is where you need to put your money. This is where you take the loan. Right?
All right.
So then Rip comes in and he's like, Beth, will you go to the county fair with me? And John decides, I'm going to tag along. Okay, no one asked you, but okay.
Oh.
Carter's going along too. And Carter is real upset that that Rip is leaving for a year. Like, did you forget you have a kid, dude?
I know.
Yeah.
And that's so, like, he calls him son. He think, like, is he really like acting like a father figure? Like, what is happening there?
I don't know.
I can't figure that relationship out.
Well, don't forget, Beth wanted the kid.
I know, but I just.
So Rip is kind of tolerating the kid, which I get, but you know. So at the fair, people are photographing John and Summer together, and he tells her, try to resist jumping my bones.
Wait a minute. I need to say it.
Okay.
Do I need you to finish, though, or can I just
No, go ahead.
He takes his hat off.
Oh, I have notes on that.
All right.
Okay. So Carter and Tate are playing a shooting game, and Tate is dominating. And I wrote, well, Tate does have experience shooting people. He, like, literally shot someone. So the bunkhouse plays some games. I just wrote, why are we doing this? Why are we wasting this kind of time? Now it gets dark, and Zach Bryan is there. And I love him. And he's playing Summertime Blues, which I love that song.
That's great.
And Beth and Rip are snuggled up, and she asks how long he'll be gone, and he says a year, and she's gonna go with him.
I know. She's
he's like, you're gonna live in a tent. You're not gonna shower. And then she's like, well, I'll stay at a Motel 6. Okay.
I think you're right, though. I think she's gonna get drunk and drive somewhere, and she's gonna die. I think you're right.
Yeah, she's not going. What are we talking about?
No, but I think she's gonna die on the trip, is what I'm saying.
Oh, maybe.
If she dies. Like you keep saying.
Ryan tells Abby she freaks out. He says, my cowboy in is your singing. Mm-hmm. And she kisses him and she's like, bye. See you later.
I know. Were you like, are you fucking kidding me, bitch? Bye.
We didn't meet her.
No.
So now we see Summer and John cuddled up and he's getting all teary. And he says, this way of life is dying. And she's like, he goes, it's already dead where you are. Now you dirty California hippies are coming here. And Summer says, have you ever thought about, like, being nice to dirty hippies? Like, inviting us into your world, letting us see what you can do, maybe understanding it instead of just, you know, writing us off like patchouli motherfuckers or whatever you called us earlier.
Leave patchouli and she out says, of this, everybody.
Stop judging people and make them brand some cattle. That's what you need to do. So she says, you've changed me. She says, tourists think that you're just a misogynist bigot. But you might want to show them how you really live. And he's like, wow, you got them woman brains. Then she thanks him for kidnapping her. And then we see Clara making out with some chick.
Was that a chick? I couldn't tell if it was a chick.
We have a character, finally. All right.
I didn't know if it was a chick or if it was an old man.
No, I think it was a chick.
I couldn't tell. It looked like a white-haired old man.
And I didn't Summer care
enough
and,
to rewind it.
Summer and John start making out. He takes his hat off. And we see.
The best part of the hat. That little tuft of like, like old man. Like it was totally stuck up under that hat. Yes. Like
we see a lot of his. Let me just say, we see a lot of his scalp.
The little wonky tuft was my favorite part of the whole fucking episode.
He looks like my hair. Like there's like 17 pieces of hair on that head.
It was amazing.
And they were all whipped into that hat.
Amy, it was everything I needed it to be.
Oh, it was wonderful. So they kiss, they make out, and that's it. And then, we get some next time on, and it's like Jamie doing his summary to the assembly there that John needs to be taken down. Oh, and then we do have a scene in the previews, Jamie saying to Beth, our father is the problem, and I'm going to take him out. And Jamie is dripping blood. So I'm assuming Beth beat the shit out of him once again. Once again. So that's it, girl.
Anybody to beat the shit out of him. Oh, what did you hate this episode?
Because that's our visit to the ranch.
What did you hate? That's what I want to talk about first.
I mean, the whole thing with Jamie being naked on the couch. Move these people to a bedroom. They are attractive people. You are doing them dirty, Taylor Sheridan.
I know.
What did you hate?
So gross. I mean, I hate the Jamie thing. I hated that Rip killed Rowdy. That's what I hated the most.
Yeah, I agree with you. All right, so guys, thank you so much for listening. If you haven't already, check out our Sister Wives coverage, which is some of it's on the free feed, but most of it's going to be on Patreon and Supercast, and those links are in the show notes. And Steph and I will be here next week with the finale.
Can't wait. The finale and then what? Ranch. Then what comes?
Virgin River. Woo-hoo. So excited. So excited.
Virgin River.
Virgin River, can't guys. Wait. We are ready. We are ready, and we're going to bring it to you. Mm-hmm. All right, guys, thank you so much for listening. Follow us on Instagram at Little Miss Recap, and leave us a review. And please. Thanks for listening. We love you. We love you. Steph, I love you.
Love you.
Love you
more. Bye. Love your bones.
Love you. Bye.